At St Pancras in London, just beside the line where high-speed trains leave for Kent and overseas, there is a little canal basin. A relic from the age when coal was dropped from trains onto barges below, it now houses the St Pancras Cruising Club, who've been around since the 1950s. Boasting a brand new clubhouse, which they're still fundraising for, the group also has its own dry dock for repairs, painting and other such works. Its entrance is just off the Regent's Canal, which opened fully by 1820 and threads its way through London for almost 9 miles, from Little Venice to Limehouse. There are 12 locks along the route, one of them immediately outside the basin, which also boasts a superb secret garden for members of the club. It's nothing to do with this cruise, but I have to give a quick mention to the club's temporary clubhouse, which is an historic water tower that never used to be here, but was moved, literally the whole building, to make space for the Eurostar trains.
Well, the water point used to be the water supply for the steam engines at St Pancras Station. So it was a George Gilbert Scott development at the back of St Pancras Station, actually attached to it. And when the Eurostar terminal was created, it had to be moved. Being Grade 2 listed, it couldn't just be demolished, and so it was moved after being sliced into three and lifted onto site. And the current custodians are Heritage of London's Buildings Trust, and we actually rent it for them for a peppercorn, but we have responsibilities to show the public around and to take care of it.
Back to the cruise, and an armada of boats would, over the course of the day, assemble at Limehouse Basin, ready to go out onto the River Thames the next day for a trip out past the Thames flood barrier, as well as up through central London. I've done the central London part before, but have never turned left from Limehouse to head downstream and through the barrier, so I was really looking forward to it. First, though, the boats had to get to Limehouse, and that's why we set off for the cruise along the Regent's Canal, named after the Prince Regent, aka King George IV. My host today was a familiar one, if you saw the video I made about the Cambridge Backs. Simon Judge, the owner of Scholar Gypsy, is also a key member of the St Pancras Cruising Club. Simon had all the essentials for a Thames trip, a VHF radio and a cup of tea. Into St Pancras Lock, the one that's just outside the club. It's quite a decent drop. We were joined by narrowboat Dragonfly. As the water flowed out, the sluice paddles on the gate became visible. A glimmer of light through the gates means the water levels dropped enough for them to open. So the crew put their backs into it and levered the heavy gates out of the way. We were off, in tandem it seemed, though we were not actually tied together. That's the new Google headquarters being built. And that's a fish on a bicycle. Halfway down this basin is the London Canal Museum. It's small but worth a look, and my friend Lorna has made an excellent video about it. I've left a link to that in the description below. I I'm not a fan of London, but it has to be said the canals here are big enough to support quite the varied selection of boats. This is a two-day trip, and Simon has been kind enough to say I can stop on board overnight, so I brought all the essentials. I've got my sleeping bag, I've got a cheese sandwich, actually cheese and ham, going out on a bit of a limb there, and I've also brought my favourite reading app on the iPad. It is Readly, and they are the sponsor of today's video. I've mentioned them before, but I make no apologies for mentioning them again, because Readly is ace. If you are unaware, Readly is an app you download, you sign up to their service, and for a very, very low and reasonable monthly fee, you get access to a library of quite literally thousands of different magazines, newspapers, and now podcasts as well, on every conceivable topic. These are exactly the same magazines that you would get if you popped into your local newsagent, but all in digital form, so you can keep them all nice and compact, ideal when you're going away on a narrowboat for a weekend, or at home, or wherever. If you're going on a plane, you can download them in advance, so you don't have to actually have internet access to be able to read them. And it's the same magazines. It's a digital copy, so you're flipping through the pages with your finger, exactly like you'd be flipping through the magazine, but without actually having to lug a paper magazine around with you and then find somewhere to dispose of that paper. So it's kind of more environmentally friendly. I mean, I had the iPad anyway, so if I've got the app, I can just download all these magazines. It's a vast library, and it includes, delightfully, Waterways World, Canal Boat, and Towpath Talk, my favourite narrowboating magazines, as well as loads of others. I've got What Car and Auto Car, things like that. Whatever you like, there will be something in the Readly app. They're offering a two-month free trial. If you use the link in the description below and showing on screen now, 2 months free trial, you can cancel at any time, so there's no worrisome commitment. You're not going to be signed up to something you just can't get out of. And 2 months is a good amount of time to have a look around, look at the library, bury through the archives. They have all the back issues as well. Someone actually messaged me the other day to say they're using Readly to look through when I used to write for Waterways World and Canal Boat magazine. Now that was, I think, at least 5 years ago, and they've gone back through the back issues on Readly, and they're enjoying reading my old articles. So if you fancy doing the same, sign up now, link in the description below. I really like Readly. I have said to you before, I won't plug products I don't like. I like Readly, I use Readly, I've got all my stuff on here. I've got Auto Express, Campervan magazine, and I've also been using its discovery features. It suggests things you might like based on what you've been reading, so it suggested other sort of campervanning magazines, but I've also found myself reading things like New Scientist magazine, getting myself a bit educated. If you want to have a go, 2 months free trial, just click on the link below, give me your details, and do not worry, you're not signing up to something you cannot get out of, but I think you will like it. We approached Islington Tunnel, 878 metres long, and opened in 1818. Unless otherwise indicated on an official sign, the rule with tunnels is to peer in and see if anyone's coming the other way. In this case, there was, so we waited. After an interminable amount of time, they emerged, and were followed by another boat, who confirmed no others behind him. So in we plunged. And out to Colebrook Row. City Road lock is next and needed filling, so Tony went to sort it. Scholar Gypsy idled up as the lock filled. Filling was slow going as the paddle gear on the far side was out of action, and with so many boats coming along in our convoy, this was not helpful. There was almost enough time to pop into the cafe by the lock for a quick cheese sarnie, but I resisted. This is what you emerge to, a huge basin which once would have supported much trade from the barges of old, and the onward path of the Regent's Canal. At last the lock was full and the gates open. Scholar Gypsy and Dragonfly could come in. With 9 locks for us to do in total, it was going to be quite a long cruise. We approached an appropriately named pub, which dates back to at least 1863. What do you call those big, flat, sticky out things on the side of boats? I know there is a proper word for them. They're more like ships than canal boats. Here's Sturt's Lock. You get quite the sense of height sometimes, like looking over the edge of the disc world. No turtles though, but a crow as lock supervisor who strutted around quite self-importantly. The lock gates really are quite chunky things which weigh many tons, and despite the balance beams can be quite an effort to open and close. Two were needed to get this one shutting behind us. We were just over 2 hours into the trip by now. I love the contrast of the old warehouse with the 1960s blocks of flats behind. This is the reality of London boating. Every possible mooring space is taken. It's so crowded, but it does have a specific kind of community feel among the boaters. in there is Kingsland Basin with residential moorings. Suddenly, we spotted a potential hazard ahead, a huge floating mass of kids in canoes and kayaks having a training session. Fortunately, they saw us too and moved aside, little realising that 17 other narrowboats would be following. The yellow thing is an inflatable art studio which won a competition, and the shark is one of five which had a planning dispute with the council about being put in the canal. Presumably, the other four lost their case. Speaking of unusual things floating in the canal, that flamingo looks familiar and should do to anyone who saw my last London boating video. Yes, it's artist Rika Hovenen and her dog Bowie on the roof, who you'll notice is quite happy and quiet. If you have hanging tyres, expect them to be used as nests. Overhead, big birds heading for Heathrow. Our fourth lock was Acton's lock. We followed Dragonfly out this time and went past a tight squeeze in the canal because of some sort of construction on the right. There's a twist or turn or two before the canal settles into a long straight with a park to our left, no doubt why it's so popular for mooring, and Old Ford Lock ahead. One thing of note about the locks on this canal is not only are they double width, but they used to be double locks, I mean two separate wide locks side by side, but apparently they never built any overflows for high water, so now as the boating traffic is much less than the working days, the second lock is disused other than as an overflow for the first. We got a glimpse of Victoria Park while waiting, Britain's oldest public park. Opened in 1845, it covers 86 hectares. Apparently the park is part of a green corridor of trees and wildlife that runs along the route of the canal. There's that lock overflow seen from the bottom. We were now heading south-ish on the final stretch towards Limehouse. You can see the office buildings of Canary Wharf in the distance. Simon's sister Hilary was steering as he chatted to me and to the other boaters in the convoy. About half of the 30-plus boats that would be on the Thames trip the next day were already moored on Limehouse Cut, It was going to be quite the collection. Quite a collection of plants on top of this boat, proving you don't have to have a garden to have green fingers. On the right here is Queen Mary University of London, widely known for its medical teaching and research. The lovely old lockkeeper's cottage has been uglified by turning it into a research centre with this monstrosity on the side and around the back. It stands next to Mile End Lock, meaning we had three more to go after this. You get a better view of how the second lock is now used as an overflow channel here. But there's also a second spillway I see around the side of that. At least there's no water shortage here. After it being very quiet so far, we suddenly met another boat coming the other way. We all waved at each other and shouted hellos. Lock number 10.
We are very nearly at Limehouse, which is our destination for the day. We'll moor up there with the rest of the convoy and hopefully have a spot of lunch.
My rumbling stomach was taunted by this cafe. True, I did have a sandwich with me, but it seemed rude to scoff my own food while everyone else was busy driving the boat and working the locks and all that. Victory Bridge, according to the CRT map. Grey Crescent Bridge, according to Google. That's a better view of Canary Wharf, although we'd get much closer still the next day when we went out on the Thames. I did, of course, film the second day, and it'll be the next video after this one. Bit of a polyamorous coot family here, with three adults doing the parenting of the babies. Very modern. And some teenagers, giving their mum grief, no doubt. Limehouse Basin lies through that lock. At 2 p.m. precisely, the gates opened to our destination for the day. Some little narrowboats are moored in here, and some not so little boats, reminding you that the massive River Thames is on the other side of the basin. We were heading for the visitor moorings, which had been block booked by the St Pancras Cruising Club especially for this event. That's the lock out to the Thames which we'd take in the morning. The convoy began to arrive and moor. That evening at the clubhouse of the local cruising association, we had extensive safety briefings and planning outlines for the next day, after which we had a rather nice meal. and then to bed. An early start beckoned. Good night